Hi everyone, this is Research Like a Pro with DNA question and answer series, and in this video we have Diana discussing the new ancestry clusters. And this is where you can view your matches by cluster, and this is a new feature that has been rolled out to some users and will be rolled out to the rest by the end of the year, and it's only for those who pay for the extra subscription for Ancestry Pro Tools. So in this video, Diana discusses how you can use the clusters to help you with your DNA research, and maybe this will help you decide if you want to upgrade to use the Pro Tools so that you can have this feature. This is an excerpt from our recent Research Like a Pro with DNA Office Hours session, so hopefully this is helpful for you.
All right, let's talk about the new ancestry clusters that we have all been excited about. This is a Pro Tool feature. So if you had Pro Tools, you maybe have seen this pop up. It did say on the website that everyone will have it by the end of the year, and I have no idea how they are deciding who gets it. But I was excited when I saw it pop up in my features, and so I can demonstrate it, and then you can hopefully use it or wait until it comes for you. So right now, it will cluster your matches between 65 and 1300 centimorgans in a grid view, but there is one caveat. If there are more than 100 clustered matches, then you won't see the grid view. So I'll show you what you will see instead. You still see you get your clusters, but just in a little different way. And this can replace the Leeds method. You know, we've used the Leeds method for several years. It's been such a wonderful tool because it could help us take our match list or that match list that someone has shared with us, someone who's tested for us, and divide it into the grandparent lines. Well, this will do that for us automatically. And so that's going to save us time. Plus, there's some really neat features that it can do for us. We can do clustering by parent. So we can choose either paternal or maternal to have the clustering done. And I was happy to see that there will be custom clusters coming soon where we can say how many centimorgans we want it to cluster or specific matches that we want it to cluster. This is going to be exciting when we can get more specific. And we'll take what we can get right now, but this is going to be really neat. And then from the website, Angie Bush wrote this blog, and she states that it works best when there isn't significant pedigree collapse or endogamy. And so we've known that, you know, that clustering is difficult when you have got everybody sharing with everybody else. It's the case where you run trying to do a cluster chart, say over on genetic affairs, and then you get just one huge blob back. Or if you do a network graph and you just have a huge blob. And so we may also see that with this type of clustering on Ancestry, this automatic clustering. But just know that there's no reason not to try it and see what you can do. And it might be with the custom clustering, we can figure out some ways to work around that if we do have a case of pedigree collapse or endogamy. So how do you find the clusters? And it will just appear when you get this if you have Pro Tools. So when you go to your match page, up here at the top, you will see a new little icon that says by cluster. And then you can click that. And then it will say, give me some time, basically. And it can take some time the first time it clusters. I know the first time that I ran my clustering, it took a few minutes, probably a good 10, 15 minutes. But now when I run it, it's very fast. So I am guessing that once it does it for a test, it has gathered the data. I'm not sure what the workings are behind the scenes, but I've just noticed that the first time I run it for any particular test, it does take a few minutes. And then after that, it goes much faster. So I decided to show you what it looks like for my all clusters. So you can select if you want all your matches or just paternal or maternal. So my all cluster, where I did everybody in my match list, was over 100 matches. So I didn't get to see the grid view like I'll show you in just a minute. Instead, I see this view where it just names my clusters and it goes from the largest to the smallest. So I have a large maternal cluster and then a smaller maternal cluster and then a few paternal clusters and then a small maternal cluster. So it's going back and forth between paternal and maternal, but you can see how valuable this would be to just start getting that big match list divided up for you. So when I do click on one of these, this is my paternal one, there's like a little arrow here. When I click on that, then it does open up the grid for this set of matches. So you do get this nice grid, and this has got some really neat features. So this has got some exciting things within it. And I think that's so valuable just to use this. So let's take a look and see what it does. So this is my paternal clusters. When I went and changed it to paternal, you can see right here I did paternal. Now I get the grid view that I couldn't get when I had over 100. And so here you've got your matches across the top, and then you've got the same matches coming down the side, just like in all of our cluster charts. And then this line coming down here represents where this person intersects with himself. And so this is John, and this is John, and he becomes this dark square here. So anytime you click on one of the dark squares, you're going to get information about the DNA match, because that's where the two different their names intersect. And so when you click on that, then you can learn about what you've put in there for your match. Not only do you get to see what Ancestry gives you, such as how much DNA you share with the match, you also get to see if you have done some work with that match. So if you've given it colored dots, you'll see the colored dots. If there's the icon for common ancestors, there's an icon for trees. And if you have notes, you'll get to see notes about that match. And so this goes to show that we really need to continue to put good information in about our matches, because the more information we have about our matches, the more valuable it will be to use these clusters. We'll be able to quickly identify the common ancestral couple for each cluster. We'll just be able to learn more about how everybody's connecting in our DNA match list. Now, if you click on one of these squares that's not the actual person where the two names of the person intersect, then you're going to get information about how that DNA matches, how much DNA the two matches share with each other. So let's say I have John here and I've got Susan here. When I click on that match, I get to see how much they share. And so this is one of the Pro Tool features that we've been able to use, but we've had to go to our match list, click on John, then click on shared matches with John, and then find Susan, and then see how much they shared. This way, we have all these people in one cluster. And then when we click on different people through here, we get to see how much they share with each other just so easily, just from working right within this one screen and not having to go back and forth. And so as we fill out, you know, our research log, our DNA match details, let's say we're doing a project and it's all about, say, this cluster down here, we can pretty quickly find a lot of information just straight from the screen. Now, just like other cluster charts like this, we have to understand, whoops, what the gray squares are as well. So a DNA match can only be in one color cluster. So John cannot be both in pink and over here in blue. So let's say this is John's line right here. You can see that John also shares a lot of DNA with all these people down here in the blue cluster. So just to give you an idea of how this works and how I interpreted this, I thought I'd put the names of the ancestor couples here. So this is my dad's line. This is my paternal clusters. Here's my dad, Bobby Jean Schultz, and then his dad was Charles Leslie Schultz, and Eddie Bell Harris was his mom. So I have these four basic lines, the Schultz, the Roysons, the Harrises, and the Frasers. And all of these people here are coming through the Schultz line. Some of them come straight from William Houston Schultz. Some of them go back another generation to his dad or his mom. But they share DNA with, you know, all the descendants here and here. And so they all group together here in this cluster. But they also share DNA with a lot of these people share DNA with his wife, Dora Algy Royston. So because they had 10 children and they have a lot of children, there's a lot of descendants here that come through both lines, but they can only be in one of these clusters. And so they're going to appear here, and they're also going to have gray squares connecting them to people down here in the Royston cluster. So you're going to see that, pretty obvious. Now, this group right here is exactly the same as this group right here. It's just that that's how it's manifesting. So these are not different people in these two different things. This is the same. These gray squares are all the same as these gray squares. They're the same people. So let's say we have Elizabeth here, and she's also here too, showing that she connects to the Royston group. So the Harris group is interesting because I have matches through the Harrises, but basically going back another generation here, this grandparent couple only had two children and they had very few children. And so I don't have hardly any cousins here. So most of these matches are back a generation to Claude, who he went by Doc Harris. He had nine siblings and they all had a ton of children. So most of these matches are coming through that. And so I have not found very many coming through this Fraser line. And in fact, this little group down here that's a different color, they're all still Roystons. So I would have to go to a smaller, centimorgan range to pick up some of the people from this line. Because for whatever reason, they just haven't tested. I don't, we don't know why sometimes we don't have groups that don't show up as well. So if you do this with a test like your own, where you already know a lot of the matches, you know your lines, it'll help you to really understand what you can do with this because you'll be familiar with your matches. And then, of course, when you go to work with somebody's matches you don't know, you'll be able to make sure that you are interpreting it correctly. So, how can these clusters help our research? We always want to know, well, how's it going to help us? What good is it going to be? Well, if somebody has shared their DNA match list with us or taken a test for us, when we go into it, we can use this clustering to right away start seeing who all these people are. And one of the other things I noticed was that it can pull up double cousins or multiple relationships that might show you something like that. So I'm going to go back here for just a minute. This person right here was an interesting one because this person has, matches to all of the Schultz group, but then they also have a few random ones to the Harris group. And as I showed you, those two don't cross over, or they shouldn't. But I do have an instance where we do have some type of a crossover, and I've seen it in just a couple of matches. And so this can give you a clue if you've got someone out here in the middle, and you're thinking, well, why do they share DNA with people here too? So I noticed the three different people that were sharing, and they're all from the same family. So somewhere on one of their lines, there's a crossover. So it can be just a good visual to help us understand when we need to explore a line a little bit more. Now, something else that you can do when you have your matches is just really quickly give them all a colored dot, add them to a group. So for that paternal match, that purple match, I can just say there are quite a few here with my cousin Gary, who has given me permission to use his name in any of my presentations. I could really quickly give them all a colored dot that goes back to William Houston Schultz and Dora Algie Royston. So that can be very helpful if you're working with, say, an adoptee or just, like I said, someone else's DNA that you are not familiar with. You can get a group and you could find the common ancestor, and then pretty quickly, you could have up to 30, 40 people that you could assign a colored dot right off the bat. So I think this is going to save us a lot of time, and it's going to be exciting to see how we can learn to use it, and especially when we can do custom groups, how that's going to help us with our research. All right. So thanks, Robin, for putting in the definition of a centromere. So let me just read through this. It's a constricted region of a chromosome that separates it into a short arm and a long arm. During cell division, the chromosomes first replicate so that each daughter cell receives a complete set of chromosomes. Following DNA replication, the chromosome consists of two identical structures called sister chromatids, which are joined at the centromere. Okay, there's our scientific explanation for the day, and I'm not even going to try to discuss that, but thank you for finding that. And then the comment, I only have four clusters, sizes 8, 4, 3, and 3. Yeah, everybody's DNA is so different. So I think that the clusters will be more helpful for some people than others. And I think it's going to be interesting to see how it evolves.